This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hello, friends, and welcome to this joint worship service between Arvada Presbyterian Church of Arvada, Colorado, and First Presbyterian Church of Logan, Utah. I'm Derek Forbes, pastor of First Pres Logan, and we will shortly be joined by Reverend Gretchen Sosville and Reverend Megan Vale for this service, and also by musicians from Arvada Pres. It's my distinct privilege to be welcoming you to this worship service today. These two congregations have been foundational in my own walk with Jesus across four decades. I grew up in Arvada Pres as a child. I served as an elder there, later was supported by APC while I went off to seminary and when I was a mission co-worker in Zimbabwe. It's also the church where I was ordained as a minister and where Laura and I were married 2 years ago this Tuesday. And I've been serving First Pres Logan for nearly 8 years now, a church equally near and dear to my heart. It's joyful for me that these two congregations are worshiping together this day, and I hope the same is true for you. Some time ago, Gretchen and I decided to hold a joint worship service as we continue to worship from home in the interest of public and personal health and safety. And a few weeks from now, we will do this again, but we'll switch up the roles. Pastor Gretchen will preach, and First Pres Logan will provide the music and liturgy. The psalmist reminds us that our help is in the name of the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. Will you please pray with me? God of all glory, on this first day you began creation, bringing light out of the darkness. On this first day you began your new creation, raising Jesus Christ from the darkness of death. On this Lord's Day, grant that we, the people you create by water and the Spirit, may be joined with all your works in praising you for your great glory. Through Jesus Christ, in union with the Holy Spirit, we praise you now and forever. Amen. Let us worship the Lord together.
It is wonderful to be with you today. I am the Reverend Gretchen Sosville, the pastor of Arvada Presbyterian Church, and we are so excited to be worshiping with our friends in Logan and our friends in Arvada and all our friends in between. It has been a joy to work with Derek. And a fun fact, in the 2 to 3 years that I've known Derek, you find out in the Presbyterian world that we have lots of connections all over. In fact, Derek's favorite professor, I think it's his favorite professor in seminary, was actually my childhood pastor. So the connectional church. Arvada Presbyterian Church this summer is doing a book series from the book Inspired by Rachel Held Evans. And the chapter that we read this week is actually about the walls. That the humans build in the name of God. And God is not a God of walls, but God is a God that tears down the walls and creates gardens where there once was a wall and connectivity between people. And I think that this worship service really speaks to how we have broken down walls in this time of a pandemic where we can do online worship with our friends in Logan or our friends around the world who tune into us. So it is a joy to be here today in the spirit of the God who breaks boundaries and walls and allows us to worship together as God's people. I want to thank Meg and Derek for their worship leadership this morning, as well as the staff of Arvada Presbyterian Church. And as God's people, one of the ways in which we break down walls is by praying together. So friends, let us find a posture and a spirit of prayer this day, and let us pray. Lord our God, we, your people, come to you this day, fully aware that we need your presence and your help in our lives, yet aware as well that we often fail to stop and to turn to you for that help. Lord, we pray for many this day, for the angry and the expectant, for the bereft and for the brokenhearted, the humble, the humiliated, for the hungry, for the cold, for the confused, for the caretaker, for the cancer, for the aches and the pains and the aged and the breadwinners and the left and the lonely and the lost, for the lynched. We pray for the fearful and reluctant, for the frustrated and the friendless, for the pained and the privileged, the injured and the idle, for the thief and the attendant, for the doctor and the nurses and leaders, for those who question them, for those who pray for them. We pray for the murdered and the murderer, for the just and the justified and unjust, for truth to prevail, for love to win the day, for the sick, for the scared, for the dying, for the dead, for the resurrected, for the grandbaby, for the graduate, for the maskless, for the recovering, for the impatient and the impatience, for the bored, for the restless, for the teacher, for those who long for another way. Lord, we get so caught up in the troubles and turmoils of daily living. We become busy with the goals that we have set for ourselves and those that come to us from our work and our families and our friends. We strive to be loving. We strive to seek joy and peace. We desire to be gentle and patient and kind, to show your goodness and to have self-control. And yet these things all too often elude us. Help us, Lord, to root ourselves more deeply in you, to seek your will for our lives, to stop and to listen for your voice when we are troubled, to fully rely on you when we strive to do what is right, to remember you and trust in you when we trust not, to meditate on your goodness and your gracious will when we begin each day, so that like trees by a stream, like plants on a vine, like flowers in the summer twilight,
that the roots will go down to the earth for water, and their blooms will rise up to the sky and the sun to meet you. May we, like them, produce power and the fruits of your spirit manifest in us. We lift these prayers to you in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The second scripture reading this morning is from the book of Exodus, chapter 16, verses 14 through 30. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Gather as much of it as each of you needs, an omer, approximately 9 cups, to a person, according to the number of persons, all providing for those in their own tents." The Israelites did so, some gathering more, some less. But when they measured it with an omer, those who gathered much had nothing over, and those who gathered little had no shortage. They gathered as much as each of them needed. And Moses said to them, "Let no one leave any over until morning." But they did not listen to Moses. Some left part of it until morning, and it bred worms and became foul. And Moses was angry with them. Morning by morning they gathered it, much as each needed. But when the sun grew hot, it melted. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much food, 2 omers apiece. When all the leaders of the congregation came and told Moses, he said to them, "This is what the Lord has commanded. Tomorrow is a day of solemn rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. Bake what you want to bake and boil what you want to boil, and all that is left over, put aside to be kept until morning." So they put it aside until morning, as Moses commanded them, and it did not become foul, and there were no worms in it. Moses said, "Eat it today, for today is a Sabbath to the Lord. Today you will not find it in the field. 6 days you shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is a Sabbath, there will be none." On the seventh day, some of the people went out to gather, and they found none. The Lord said to Moses, "How long will you refuse to keep my commandments and instructions? See, the Lord has given you the Sabbath. Therefore, on the sixth day, he gives you food for 2 days. Each of you stay where you are. Do not leave your place on the seventh day." So the people rested on the seventh day. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
I lift my voice and sing to God. Save me from the sea, and God has triumphed gloriously. Save me from my enemies, and I will sing of glory.
to our friends in Logan and Arvada, and to our friends who may be tuning in to worship today from other communities. At First Presbyterian Logan, Pastor Derek Forbes and I have been preaching a July sermon series on summer stories, lessons you learned as a kid, drawing primarily on Paul's letter to the Galatians and our own life journeys to reflect upon the fruit of the Spirit, and to explore how the fruit of love, peace, and patience took root in our own lives as children. Today, our series turns to the book of Exodus, to the wandering Israelites who are fresh from a celebration of independence from Pharaoh and from their former lives as slaves in Egypt. Having crossed the Red Sea on dry land before the waters consumed the Egyptians in pursuit of them. The Israelites have partied with song, and Aaron's sister Miriam led the women in dancing with tambourines. Today's passage finds the Israelites in a wilderness area between Elim and Sinai. What unfolds in this passage reveals that the price of Israel's freedom from Pharaoh seems to be wilderness rummaging and skepticism with Moses' leadership. And for this, the Israelites cry out to the Lord, fearful that they have escaped one form of bondage for another, from slavery to a place where they believe that they are at risk of experiencing constant hunger. Does this sound like a lesson that you learned as a kid? No, I didn't think so. Outside of stories about our religious history and ancestry that have been published for kids, there's no comparable childhood novel that comes to mind for me. In this fragile exchange that happens between Moses, Yahweh, and Israel in today's verses, we are more likely to picture ourselves in the role of the Israelites and to imagine Moses as that parent from our childhood who is patiently asking us to trust things that we cannot explain or understand. Moses would be justified in saying, "I asked you to do two things, to gather only what you need, and to make plans not to gather on the Sabbath or seventh day." Do we need a timeout? Many of us could plead guilty to having been the child in the backseat of the car that asks, "Are we there yet?" for the 50th time on a road trip, or the child that asks, "Why?" every single time a parent asks us to do something. As adults who have made a home in the church, many of us may admit to identifying with the Israelites in this passage, when they disregard Moses' instructions from Yahweh to refrain from gathering bread on the seventh day. And as church people, we often are inclined to be thrifty, practical, and resourceful, are we not? We can be guilty of getting a little anxious when the supply does not exceed the demand, musicians for special music, revenue for the budget, committee members for our particular ministry, volunteers for that beloved annual event, bulletins for a given Sunday. Despite the fact that fellowship potlucks have taught us firsthand that there will always be enough to go around. The epistle writer Paul might contend that what God's people lack in this Exodus narrative is the spiritual fruit of self-control. But I suspect that the Israelites are merely learning to grow in confidence that they are watched over by a loving and providential God. And whether we are children or adults, we are accustomed to recognizing God's providence, God's spiritual provision and care for creation, when life is going well for us, when our bases are covered, when work or family matters are Facebook status update or tweet worthy. We might be guilty of using the hashtag blessed to ostensibly give glory or credit to God for something that in our heart of hearts we believe is to our credit. And by the same token, when life throws us a curveball, we are more likely to face a crisis of faith. We wonder where God has gone when we encounter hardship, because our discerning lens of faith is so troubled by a particular difficulty that we can no longer locate God's provision in our ordinary day-to-day living. Many of us will enter this particular Exodus story with a specific memory of personal hardship, past or present. We have known the wilderness ourselves, and it has likely been a place in which we feel we have been separated from God's gracious provision. It leaves us feeling angry or disappointed or confused, not unlike the Israelites. And after all, we are human. In the wilderness, Israel is confronted first with absence of reliable agriculture, of safe food, the familiarity of their dependent existence in Egypt. The initial hardship faced by this traveling community of faithful people is so disorienting that they reimagine Egypt as a place of abundance, in contrast with the scarcity of the wilderness they have come to know. And yet a moment of transformation happens that alters their expectation and their lens on the present reality. Egypt, they properly recall, is a place of scarcity and scarce opportunity, ruled by a pharaoh who accumulated things out of fear. And the wilderness is seen for what it truly is, a place of abundance where people receive what they need and there is enough for everyone. As the famous Old Testament theologian Walter Brueggemann has observed, this narrative is about the relative power of Pharaoh and Yahweh, about the waning and defeat of Pharaoh's power, and about the truth of Yahweh's resolve. If Egypt was Pharaoh occupied, the wilderness, Israel discovered, was God occupied, and that would mean all the difference. Friends, I am convinced that this is providence itself. A God who reveals to us that places and circumstances disguised as wilderness are in fact places and circumstances of abundance. When we have the self-discipline to really listen, not necessarily for what we want to hear, but rather for words that reveal God's faithfulness to us and show us God's resolve. With God's providence, we may not solve the timeless mystery of why suffering? Why do bad things happen to good people? But with God's providence, our seasons of hardship and our private wilderness are and will always be, to borrow from Brueggemann, God occupied. I wonder if this is the lesson we can impart to our children. We may never lead them to a desert place, and yet we can make it known that when a moment or circumstance resembling a desert appears, we need only look for signs of God's abundant grace and provision. If we embrace this understanding of a providential God who occupies our wilderness and is resolved to show us abundance, whatever that may be for us, then the question we are left with today as we prepare to close our time of worship and to worship God with our daily living is, how should we listen for God's faithfulness, both in our ordinary days and in our time of unusual hardship? I invite you to dwell for a few moments with the energy of verses 14 and 15 in this chapter from Exodus. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. What is it? I can't imagine a more fitting question for us to comprehend the ordinary providence of God than this. Because the question, what is it, is not just a practical question about the flaky substance that will later be identified as manna. Hidden in those three words are a universe of other questions. Where does it come from? How is it possible? What does it mean? And perhaps most compelling, what do I do now? There are communal and personal dimensions to these questions that touch on the providence of God. The Israelites turn to one another, to the community, in order to interpret the nature of the substance before receiving guidance from Moses. And having received the Lord's command through Moses, they evaluated what that command intended for them individually, gathering as much as each of them needed. As one scholar has reminded us, God's gifts to Israel are to be found not only in the unusual, but also in the everyday. The same is true of us. When a sense of God's gracious presence or seeming absence strikes you in the midst of your day, I invite you to the curiosity of this question: what is it? And to the others that unfold: where does it come from? How is it possible? What does it mean? And what do I do now? We trust that we can do nothing to earn God's providence and provision in our lives, because we can only receive it with grateful hearts. It is a gift for people of faith who will occasionally dwell in a God-occupied wilderness. So let us examine the dimensions of that flaky substance, that manna, together, guided by the Spirit of God. Let us ponder its purpose, wonder what it asks of us, and where it leads us. Let us look and listen for God to reveal God's faithfulness and to show us God's resolve, like a spring that pours forth in the desert or a surprising substance on the ground. Amen.
We pray the prayer Walter Brueggemann wrote, called Waiting and Longing. God of the seasons, God of the years, God of the eons, Alpha and Omega, before us and after us, God of manna and quail, God of deep wells and broken walls, God of patience and love, God of abundant fruit and Spirit of time. You promise and we wait. We long with eager longing. We wait amid doubt and anxiety. We wait with patience thin and then doubt. And then we take life into our own hands. We wait because you are the one, the only one. We wait for your peace and your mercy, for your justice and your good rule. Give us your Spirit that we may wait obediently and with discernment, caringly and without passivity, trusting and without cynicism, honestly and without utopianism. Grant that our wait may be appropriate to your coming, soon and very soon, soon and not too late, late but not too late. We wait while the world groans in eager longing. Let the people of God say, Amen, Amen, Amen.
Go, my children, with my blessing, never alone. Waking, sleeping, I am with you. You are my own. In my love's baptismal river, I have made you mine forever. Go, my children, with my blessing. My children, sins forgiven, at peace and pure. Here you learned how much I love you, what I can cure. Here you heard my dear son's story. Here you touched him, saw his glory. Go, my children, sins forgiven, at peace and pure. Go, my children, fed and nourished, closer to me. Grow in love and love by serving, joyful and free. Hear my spirit's power filled you. Hear my tender comfort stilled you. Go, my children, fed and nourished, joyful and free, joyful and free.
People of God, let us go out into the world rejoicing in the often unseen but very real presence and providence of our God. In our days of joy and in our days of wilderness, let us look and listen for God's faithfulness. What is it? What does it mean? And may the love of our God, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the wisdom of the Holy Spirit be with all of us to guide us this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.